The Elephant to Hollywood. Written and read by Michael Caine. Prologue. Well, it's a long way from London's Elephant and Castle to Hollywood, and the shortest distance between two points is not always a straight line, as my story is going to prove. But then I've never been known for doing things the easy way. I wouldn't have minded easy, but things just never worked out like that. In fact, although I couldn't have known it at the time, they worked out a whole lot better. 18 years ago, I thought that my career as an actor was over, so I wrote my autobiography, What's It All About, to round off my professional life. And that, as far as I was concerned, was that. Fortunately, and not for the first time, I was wrong. Very wrong. The best was yet to come. Which, when you look back at my life, the crazy 60s, the stardom, the glitz and glamour of Hollywood, it's really saying something. The last 18 years have been different. Different style, different places, and different ideas of happiness. But different has not only been good, it has been better than I could ever have imagined. So this is a story of a man who thought it was all over and found out it wasn't. It's a story of the last 18 years, but it's also the story of where I came from and where I'm going. I know many people have read my first book, but you don't get to my age without looking back, and God knows I've been to plenty of memorial services. So I'm not going to apologize for telling some of the old tales, but there are plenty of new stories too, because I've had the good fortune to work with a whole new generation of movie stars. And that puts me in a uniquely privileged position. There aren't many actors whose career has spanned nearly 50 years of movie making, from Zulu to The Dark Knight. And there aren't many actors who have had Happy Birthday sung huskily and Marilyn-like into their ear, both by Carly Simon and Scarlett Johansson, 20 years apart. Everyone gets lucky now and then, and I've had some lucky breaks. I've been lucky too with friends and agents and supporters who have all looked out for me. But if there's one person I feel I owe for the way the last 18 years have gone, it's Jack Nicholson. In fact, if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be reading this book to you now. I have Jack to thank for the resurrection of my movie career. I know he's not everyone's idea of a fairy godmother, but he did it for me. I'll explain how later. But it could have all been very different. This is not a serious tome by a pompous old actor. Above all, I am an entertainer, so please feel free to laugh. I want to share the joy and the fun and the good fortune I've had with friends, to tell you about things I've done and the places I've been, and about how, when I got there, it was never the way I thought it would be. In many ways, this is an innocence venture into the unknown. So I'm pleased you want to come along for the ride. To you and me, bon voyage. Chapter 1. The Twilight Zone. When I finished my first autobiography, 1992 seemed to be like a good place to stop. I had a great film career, a worldwide bestseller, some restaurants, a beautiful house, and most importantly of all, a loving family. Christmas, the New Year's Eve 1991, I'd spent in Aspen, Colorado, as guests of Marvin and Barbara Davis, the Texan old billionaires and socialites. We stayed at the Little Nell Inn, which Marvin happened to own, and we were surrounded by friends, including Lenny and Wendy Goldberg, Sean Connery and his wife Micheline, and Sydney and Joanna Poitier. It was a fabulous group to spend a holiday with. I don't ski, but I have really worked hard at developing my après-ski skills. And that is what Aspen is all about. As we sat around enjoying the sunshine, gossiping about old times and eating fabulous food with this great group of people, I felt pretty happy with my lot. Everyone there had been a part of my life since I first got to Hollywood. Although, in fact, I'd met Sean in London back in the late 1950s at what was then called a bottle party. If someone was giving a party in those days and couldn't quite afford it, the invitation would be, bring a bottle and a bird. I was broke so that I couldn't afford to bring a bottle, so I brought two birds, and they were very beautiful girls. I walked into this party and there was Sean, who seemed enormous, compared with the rest of us weedy type actors, and he saw me with those two girls, and I became his instant new best friend. That period back in the 1950s was a tough time for me, perhaps the toughest I've ever known, and I was living hand to mouth through much of it, owing small sums of money to people all over London and often having to cross the road to avoid creditors. Of course, what I couldn't have foreseen was that years later, Shirley MacLaine would choose me to play opposite her in Gambit and give me a welcome to L.A. party and inward walk Sydney Poitier. And that Sydney would become my instant new best friend. Aspen with old friends was followed by a period back in Hollywood. I felt on top of the world. Things could only get better. I was completely oblivious to the downturn in store for me. My wife Shakira and I had bought a small house with a fantastic view, not on a Beverly Hill, but in the more modest district of Truesdale. It was a holiday home, really. Our main base was back in England. But we wanted to be close to our dear friend, the great agent Swifty Lazar, whose wife Mary was very sick. Apart from Mary's illness, there was no sign of impending doom. Nothing seemed to have changed. Our old friends were all in town. As with our New Year's at Aspen, the dinner we had one night at Chasen's restaurant in Hollywood with Frank and Barbara Sinatra, Greg and Veronique Peck, George and Jolene Schlatter, seemed to reflect all that was good in our lives. It was a great Hollywood evening, full of in-jokes, including a prime one from George that seemed to sum up perfectly the relationship between actors and their agent. George is one of the great TV producers, the man who discovered Goldie Hawn in his fantastic show Rowan and Martin's Laughing, and every bit as funny as the shows he's produced. I've been lucky. My agents have always been close friends, but the relationship between stars and agents is usually quite distant socially. The joke goes, an actor gets a telephone call to say that his house has been burnt down and his wife raped. The actor rushes home and a police officer meets him outside and tells him that it is his agent who has come to the house, burnt it down and raped his wife. The actor's jaw drops and he turns to the policeman and says, completely astonished, "My agent came to my house." In fact, that dinner at Chasen's and the one the following week at Barbara Streisand's, all art deco and sensational Shaker furniture, were to be the last high for quite some time. Looking back to this period, I can see now what I couldn't see then. The storm clouds, as they say, were gathering. A movie I had made the previous year, Noises Off, had come out and gone just as quickly. I wasn't too bothered. Everyone has a flop movie now and then, I thought. But it was another little sign. I took no notice. I had become part of Hollywood history. Completely out of the blue, Robert Mitchum, the great 1950s movie star, asked me to present his Lifetime Achievement Award at the Golden Globes. I loved Bob Mitchum and was honoured that he should ask me, but I didn't know him, and I'd never worked with him, and I was curious. "Did you pick me because I have heavy eyelids like you?" I asked him. And he said, "Yes, you're the only one, you know. People are always talking about my eyelids, and then I saw you in Alfie, and I thought to myself, this guy's got heavy eyelids too. They're not as heavy as mine, of course, but they're quite heavy. It's all to do with the eyelids." A charming story, and Bob was a charming guy. But I began to wonder if it was really because everyone else had turned him down. Whether or not that was the case, I've always liked the Golden Globes because you can sit at tables and get a drink and move around and talk to people. Burt Reynolds once pointed out something that everyone in the business knows, but which is rarely mentioned, the class distinction. At award ceremonies, all the television people are seated at the back and the movie people at the front. It's absurd, really. You get TV stars like those on Friends who are earning $1 million a week, and their tables aren't at the front. And I'm thinking, wait a minute, I've never earned $1 million a week. I asked one of the organisers of the Golden Globes about it, and he simply said, movies come first. I was just about to find out how true that was. Back in England, my book came out and went straight to number one, and I embarked on a world tour to publicise it. What could possibly go wrong? For a start, doing publicity on a book tour turned out to be just like doing publicity for a movie, which is something I have done and hated all my life. People tell me that movie stars are overpaid. Well, I disagree. Movie stars only get $1,000 a time for the hard work, the hours in makeup, the endless takes, the craft, the experience and the star billing. And the other million is for the publicity. And believe me, we earn every cent. I first went to America on a publicity tour for the Ipcress Viola and Alfie. It came as a big shock to be bundled out of bed at 6 a.m. My press agent, Bobby Zarum, told me that I was appearing on the Today Show at 7:30. I said, why do I have to get up at dawn to go on an evening show? He looked at me pityingly. It's 7:30 this morning, Michael. And who on earth's going to be watching at that time of day, I demanded. This time Bobby was a little firmer. 21 million people, he said. So if you want to be a star in America, you'll have to get up. I'm used to the 24/7 publicity machine now, but it doesn't mean I like it, and this tour was no different. It consisted of me giving jet-lagged interviews to journalists who hadn't even bothered to read the book, then getting on another plane and doing the same thing all over again in a different, equally fascinating and equally beautiful country that I only got to see from the car window to and from the airport. There were some really great places I never quite got to see on that tour. Hong Kong, Thailand, Australia, New Zealand, and America. I remember Chris Patten, the then governor of Hong Kong, sending an official to whip us through immigration and customs so we wouldn't be late for our first night dinner with him. We stayed at the Regent Hotel, now the Intercontinental, and Shakira and I had a jacuzzi together in the most romantic setting ever, in the middle of the roof of the penthouse apartment 30 stories up. There was nothing but the jacuzzi and a 360-degree view of the city. We spent hours in there. We must have been the cleanest tourists in the whole of Asia. Spectacular though it was, that was pretty much all we saw of Hong Kong. We went on to Bangkok. As we came out of the airport, we saw a Rolls Royce with a police escort waiting for someone. That someone turned out to be us. It all seemed a bit over the top until we hit the traffic on the freeway. I had never seen anything like it. It didn't seem to matter to our policemen whether we went on the off-ramps or off the on-ramps. We just ploughed our way into the city, doing what normally would have been a four-hour trip in under an hour. When we got to the Oriental Hotel, we were ushered into the Somerset Maugham suite. More than a bit intimidating for a first-time writer. On to Australia, New Zealand, and then to Los Angeles for the first stop in a whirlwind publicity tour, punctuated by something that was beginning to happen more and more frequently in my life, a memorial service. I suppose if I'd been looking for signs that there was a downturn in store for me, I might have taken one from the death of John Foreman, a friend and the producer of one of my favourites among all my own movies, The Man Who Would Be King. I gave one of the eulogies at his memorial service, and the others also got up and spoke, including Jack Nicholson. John Foreman was a very special kind of guy, and I'd put him in the category of the nearly greats. I think he died just before he reached his full potential, although The Man Who Would Be King is more than enough to confirm his reputation. Sitting in the packed chapel and listening as friends paid tribute to a wonderful man, I couldn't help thinking back to that film and what it had meant and still means to me. Not only was I working with a man I regarded as God, director John Huston, who had directed three of my all-time favourite films, including Treasury of the Sierra Madre, The Maltese Falcon, and The African Queen, but I was playing the part of Peachy Carnahan, a part Huston had planned for Humphrey Bogart, my screen idol. I thought back to the first time I saw The Treasury of Sierra Madre, that great film classic about a bunch of misfits searching for gold. A dream as impossible as mine to be an actor seemed then. As a teenager, I had identified with the Bogart character completely, and now I found myself in a movie directed by Huston, playing a part intended for Bogart. It seemed as if impossible dreams really could come true. The other thing that made The Man Who Would Be King so special was that I was playing opposite Sean Connery. Working with him proved to be a great pleasure, and we became even closer as a result. Sean, like me, felt he owed a great deal to John Huston. We were both very sad to hear the news many years later that he was on his deathbed. The two of us went to Cedars Sinai Hospital in Hollywood to say goodbye. When we got there, John was rambling. "I was in a boxing match," he said, "and it turns out the other guy had razors sewn into his gloves, and that's why I'm here. He finished me off, that guy, that's why I'm here." He went on about this boxer for 20 minutes, and Sean and I looked at each other, and we were both in tears. And I'd never seen Sean in tears. We left the hospital very upset, and the next thing we heard was that John had got out of bed and made two more movies. When I saw him again, I said, "The next time I come to say farewell to you, you better die or I'll bloody kill you." "You don't know how upset we were." He said, "Well, Michael, you know how it is. People get upset and people die." "Well, yes," I said, "but not twice." Back at John Foreman's service, we had some laughs, told some stories and shed some tears. And then it was on to New York for yet another book launch evening. This time it was at my friend Elaine's restaurant, and the guests included Gloria Vanderbilt, Lauren Bacall, David Bowie and Iman. The legends just floated in front of my jet-lagged eyes. I had a mind that couldn't think, not that it mattered. My tongue and lips were too tired to speak anyway. If Chasen's symbolized my Hollywood life and was a meeting place for many of my L.A. friends, then Elaine's was its New York equivalent. Elaine's is more than a restaurant, it's a New York institution, almost a salon. It was a perfect place to hold a book launch because it had always been a place where writers, actors and directors gather, from Woody Allen to the people from Saturday Night Live. Elaine herself would flip from table to table, making sure all her guests were all right. One night, there was a guy bothering me, and she came over and grabbed him by the collar and threw him out on the pavement all on her own. I protested. "That's a bit drastic. We could have got rid of him." And she said, "Nah, I don't like those sons of bitches." Elaine is a close friend, and I have lunch with her on Saturdays when I'm in New York. It's always caviar, which she pays for in cash, that she keeps in her bra. She says, "I'll get this," and dives in and pulls out a wad of cash. The party at Elaine's was the last of the tour, and from New York I went back home to England. I was absolutely shattered, but scripts had arrived while I was away. It was time to get on with the day job. Eventually, I picked myself up and sat down to read one. I was appalled. The part was very small, hardly worth doing. I sent it straight back to the producer, telling him what I thought of it. A couple of days later, the man phoned me. "No, no, no, you're not the lover. I wanted you to read the part of the father." I put the phone down and just stood there shocked. The father? Me? I headed into the bathroom and looked in the mirror. Yes, staring back at me was indeed the father. And so was someone else. In the mirror was a leading movie actor, not a movie star. I realized the only girl I'd ever get to kiss in a film again would be my daughter. The difference between a leading movie actor and a movie star, apart from the money in the dressing room, is that when movie stars get a script they want to do, they change it to suit them. A movie star says, "I would never do that."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.